Good morning. Distinguished guests, Chairman of the BCIS, Executive Director of BCIS, the panelists, students, ladies and gentlemen, and let me personally take this opportunity. I'm very happy, although on a busy schedule, that I accepted this invitation. One reason is that I have come to BCIS, which I have been visiting when I was in the intelligence industry. Sometimes as a student and as a resource person. The second point is that I see some very friendly faces that I have associated in the audience. And let me take this opportunity before I refer to the text. Take this opportunity to say good morning, sir. Honorable Attorney General, former Attorney General, Mr. Palito Fernando, who was my dear friend, my senior mentor, and later on, the Attorney General of Sri Lanka, who showed me the way to be in this position. Thank you. Good morning. Let me first take this opportunity also to thank Dr. Harin Vithanage for inviting me to deliver the keynote address at the BCIS signature seminar on transnational organized crime in Sri Lanka, the dark side of the hub. Given the relevance and timely significance, the importance of the topic, let me first congratulate the BCIS for identifying the distinguished panelists and bringing them into one platform to speak of this pressing issue. Statistics show that the profit from the transnational organized crime, which I will refer as TOC, networks amount to 1.5% of the global GDP or 7% of the world exports of merchandise. Dire consequences of TOC are experienced by countries, if I may mention some, like Mexico, El Salvador, Italy, etc. Apart from the economic ramifications, peace and stability of the countries are affected. Today, as my main theme of the topic, I would like to speak a few words about the impact of transnational organized crime has on the national security. I expect to outline the basic narrative of TOC with its spread and usage post-World War, and how the nature and the landscape has evolved over the years to what it is today. Since the end of the Cold War, there is a shift in the global governance and economy. Liberation of economy with regard to trade, finance, travel, etc. It not only created economic well-being, but gave rise to many criminal prospects throughout the world. For the first time, the world spoke and experienced the different kind of organized crime, illicit trade of goods and services across borders. Around the world, organized crime has changed strategic doctrines and threat assessments. Despite gravity of the threat, the organized crime is insufficiently understood. There is a lack of information on transnational criminal markets and trends. The few studies that exist have looked at section of the problem by sector or country rather than the big picture. And without a global perspective, there cannot be evidence-based policy effectively addressing the issue. Therefore, it is necessary for us to understand and grasp the narratives of the TOC before laying down any action. There are many activities that can be characterized as transnational organized crime, including drug trafficking, smuggling of migrants, human trafficking, money laundering, trafficking in firearms, counterfeit goods, wildlife and cultural property, and even some aspects of cybercrime, along with basic bribery and corruption. TOC not only threaten the peace and human security, but on a larger scale undermine the economic, social, cultural and political and civil assembly of societies around the world. The vast sums of money involved can compromise the legitimate economies and have a direct impact on governance, such as through corruption and even manipulation of elections. The irony of TOC is that the major illicit trade routes emanate from major economies, meaning the world's biggest trading partners are also the world's biggest markets for illicit goods and services. This not only reflects the correlation between TOC and global trade, but also the lack of regulatory and legal mechanisms to address the issue adequately. It is also inevitable that this illicit trade is facilitated through established and legal institutions such as banking, financial centers, shipping lines, and other related trade and communication networks. Ladies and gentlemen, corruption, coercion, white-collar collaborations with public and private actors lower the risk of the mafia links being exposed while increasing their profits. This model has made transnational crime one of the world's most sophisticated and profitable businesses. Over the years, the nature and the landscape of the TOC has evolved, much like the changing time and tide. There is no longer a centralized hierarchical structure managing the illicit transactions, but a wide array of loose and highly adaptable networks entangling its roots globally. The increasing role of technology and cyber facilities have proven to make things easier monitoring and effective transactions. Earlier, there was a clear distinction between the drug trafficking and other organized criminal activities. While even groups not producing drugs traffic other forms now. Another major change in the TOC landscape is seen within its money transactions. For what was earlier cash-based local enterprise is now not limited to financial institutions, but include global investments too. Transnational organized crime bring forward a serious and growing threat, not only to national, but also the international security and further severe implications for the safety of the public, public health, and democratic institutions, and also through disruption of existing economic stability across the world. Its roots can not only destabilize countries and consequently the entire region, but also hinder development. The diverse expansion of the criminal networks, resulting in the convergence of threats that were once distinct, have volatile and subverting effects today. The flexibility, adjustability, and adaptability allows for exploitation of the weak society segments to meet the selfish aims of the organized crime syndicates. While the origins of the illicit TOC trade flows emanate from the developed countries, its effects are mostly penetrated to the developing and conflict-ridden countries. Due to its weak rule of law and state institutions. Ties between the TOC cartels, government institutions, and the high-end business represents a significant threat to the economic growth and democratic institutions. Weak governance mechanisms pave way for corrupt bureaucrats who facilitate. TOC networks insinuate themselves into the political process in a variety of ways, through direct bribery, shadow economies, infiltrating financial and security sectors, through coercion or corruption, and positioning themselves as alternate providers of governance, security services, and livelihoods. The expansion of alliances with political leaders, financial institutions, law enforcement, foreign intelligence, and security agencies undermine free markets and thus the economic stability. Penetration of the TOC into government aggravate corruption, undermine the rule of law, judicial independence, free media, democratic institutions, transparency, and if not, accountability. Given the importance of these central foundations to a stable political environment and society, infiltration of fragile institutions would mean a greater harm to the social fabric, while in turn would disrupt peaceful governance, as well as empower illegal organized crime circles. Somalia is probably the best example of how uncontrolled TOC can destabilize governance and result in the state. POC further threatened major economies as well. Threats to the US economic interests caused significant damage to world financial systems through subversion, exploitation, and distortion of legitimate markets and economic activity. It is estimated by the World Bank that about $1 trillion is spent each year to bribe public officials, causing economic distortion and damage to legitimate economic activity. Ladies and gentlemen, when speaking of the underlying threats of TOC to governance and society, the role of intermediate facilitators cannot be exempted. Semi-legitimate players such as accountants, attorneys, bankers, and real estate brokers who link the illicit spectrum of the trade, providing services to customers, providers, criminals, and terrorists alike. TOC relies on industry experts to facilitate corrupt transactions and to create the necessary infrastructure to pursue their illicit schemes, such as shell corporations, offshore accountants, etc., and creating front businesses for their illegal activity and money laundering. Smugglers and traffickers rely on secure transportation networks and safe locations to disseminate activities. Organized groups also work with local criminals, leading to increased rates of corruption, extortion, racketeering, while and other sophisticated crimes at the domestic level. These criminals further turn inner remote areas into dangerous zones, risking civilian lives. In many developing countries, criminal groups traffic women and children for sexual exploitation, pornography, slavery, forced begging, pickpocketing, etc. Organized crime increases public spending for security and policing and undermines human rights standards many countries strive to preserve. United Nations Transnational Organized Crime acts as the main legal framework on top, as acts as the main legal framework laid down to address transnational organized crime. However successful combat of TOC, it requires partnership at all levels. Governments, businesses, civil society, international organizations, and people in all corners of the world have to play a part. Some aspects of critical infighting TOC include coordination, awareness, intelligence sharing, technology and capacity building, mutual legal assistance, regulation and monitoring with cooperation between actors, state and non-state, and at all levels need to be given adequate attention and commitment for effective moderation of transnational organized crime. Lastly, transnational crime will continue to grow until the particle of high profits and low risks are challenged. Tackling organized crime should emanate not only internationally, but locally as well. Stronger bureaucracy, which uphold the rule of law and strive to eradicate corruption, will soon be on its way for a state-free organized crime. Given the vast nature, complete eradication of organized crime seems near impossible. With the extended hands and dimensions, however, it can sure be mitigated and prevented at a larger scale, which will eventually wipe out organized crime. It is imperative and corrective measures that address the inception of these crimes should be addressed than preventive measures post-criminal activity. Advancing corrective measures must address the smallest link in the transnational crime web. The consumer who has the capacity to break down this engulfing web of transnational organized crime. Ladies and gentlemen, with the above what I have stated, I leave further deliberation to the elite panelists, the experts, and wish them a successful deliberations. Thank you very much.